First of all, much thanks to all the sources of inspiration throughout the years. A lot of great teachers from the past that have been here. And much thanks to all the viewers, very helpful and inspirational. Without further ado, let's jump right into this, because this morning I had the whole situation nailed to the wall. I had the ego nailed to the wall, absolutely nailed to the wall. What I'd like to say is this: big turnaround. Very subtle point here. It's quite interesting, because we tend to think that truth is something very subtle, and we're seeking for something ultra subtle, very esoteric, mystical, subtle, faint light somewhere. Whereas the truth is, the situation that I saw was the opposite of subtle. It was completely obvious, completely non-subtle. And so, you know, you think, the ego says, my gosh, that's not spiritual, it's too obvious. And then tries to throw you off track in that way. But really, truth is very simple, very obvious. You just see it and you just say, oh my gosh, how could I ever have overlooked that? It's so completely obvious, it's not subtle in the slightest bit. So there's kind of a reversal. As you're working towards it, you think this is so subtle. My gosh, how do I grasp that? And how do I get to something so subtle? Actually, it's lies that are subtle. It is all the lies, the deception is very tricky and subtle. But truth is just like, whoa. This is completely, blatantly obvious. It's so obvious. I had nailed to the wall, like a hide on the wall, if you can excuse that metaphor in today's PC world. And hopefully, you know, hopefully it's still on the wall. I expect it should be. So, let me adjust this one second. Okay. Don't give up as you're trying to find the subtlety, Don't give up. The ego is so clever, it's conditioned us to only think in terms of subtlety in when it comes to truth. And so when I say think outside the box, I mean, you know, how about looking at something that's completely obvious? Very obvious. Very, very obvious. So the spiritual path, actually, you find yourself coming face to face with the obvious. And this morning I did. I came face to face with crystalline clarity, extreme simplicity, extremely obvious. And I was just like, wow, that's a piece of cake, the entire thing. No subtlety at all there. I said, where's the subtlety? So what we do is we see the truth, and then we say, okay, but where's the subtlety? And then we go back looking for the subtlety to it, and we lose it. All the while it's on the wall there. We're not looking. You know, we've got it nailed down. We've got it screwed down. It is right there. It's not going anywhere. But we say, okay, I got that now. Now, where's all the subtlety? You know, I need to find that too. I mean, I basically saw exactly what duality is. Exactly what it is. I saw exactly what the quote-unquote goddess great mothering thing is all about. I saw exactly what that is. I saw exactly how the inevitability of this arising, exactly how that is. And actually I felt very kind of sad and almost in tears. It was like, wow, it is completely inevitable, all this stuff. Is completely obviously arises. But just a little bit of sadness, and then it quickly dissipated. So it was no trauma to it whatsoever. Again, the ego thinks that when we see the truth, we'll be devastated by it. To think that, you know, we've been missing it all this time. Didn't need to spend all this time searching for some kind of extremely fine, subtle point or something. And Now I just felt a little bit of wistful, a little bit of sadness, a little bit of ache. And then a matter of 30 seconds to a minute, it was gone, actually. So it's not anything to be frightened of. We do an amazing job in deceiving and misleading ourselves. So the clarity, what was so clear that it's I can't really capture the clarity in words. I'm thinking about how can I explain this. I can explain it, but it won't be quite as clear as seeing it. We have this capacity to see and to notice and recognize the obvious, and that definitely took place. It's just like, wow. So simple. And of course you say, oh, of course it has to happen that way, this has to happen this way, no doubt about it. Now basically we'll give a little explanation of it here. When spirit decides that it wants to replace God, what arises? A belief system arises that actually must at its foundation be based on the belief that mutual exclusives can be combined. It has to. I saw that. It's obviously. Why? Because we can't replace God. And since that's a fact and facts can't change, our efforts to do this has to include the fact that we cannot do it. But what we do is we say, yeah, okay, that's no problem. We'll just make both true, that we can't do it and we can do it. And they'll both be true. Mutual exclusives. And then we say, wait a minute, we've got a problem, we've got a conflict here. And enter the great mother, the goddess, who says, the comforting principle that has to arise and say, don't worry, my children. Don't worry, my children. I will make you feel comfortable with this irreconcilable situation. I'll comfort you. So that has to arise too. Everything that's arisen has to arise. That's kind of the thing that hit me so hard. I just said, wow. It's hitting me right now, as a matter of fact. It's what inevitably arises. It's not some like freak arising or some weird arising or something. No, it's what has to arise. It's like, oh my gosh, seeing this, oh, of course. We, and this is called duality. This is duality. Duality says, hey, okay, fact, we can't change reality, and fact, we can change reality, and they're both true, and we can find a way to be happy with this, and we can find a way so this doesn't trouble us in any way, that mutual exclusives can be integrated, and out of this integration of mutual exclusives comes a new self, a new creation, etc. And this comforting principle, as we're suffering and feeling so, we have to keep comforting ourselves and saying, yes, we can do it, yes, we can do it, yes, we can do it. That comforting principle is usually symbolized as the mothering principle, the great mother or the goddess principle, saying, yes, you can. Don't worry, my children. Yes, you can. That's duality. In a nutshell, that is duality. And that's all you really need to see. If you see it clearly, you just say, oh my gosh, of course. Yes, yeah, it's impacting me again. Yeah, no question about it. Just as that sun is impacting me, but it's okay. It's not a you know, I can handle that, the sun hitting me like that. So that is why I say, no, we can't. You know, no, we can't is really a positive affirmation of saying reality, we can only truth is true and lies will never be true. So no, we cannot integrate mutual exclusives. The attempt to do so causes a state of total disorientation within us, within our mind. And we can't never be comfortable with that. Guaranteed, we can never be comfortable with a sense of eternal disorientation as far as identity and everything, just complete confusion about identity, seeming to go on eternally. We can never abide in that. I don't care if the great mother, or the great goddess, whoever, says, I can help you with this. Cannot. 1 minute, please. All right, there we go. The sun is... So duality is actually very simple. Very simple. And it's just, wow. Not a trouble to see it. It's not a trouble to see it. And it has to arise. When we chose the idea of wanting to change reality, this whole situation had to arise where the belief that mutual exclusives can both be true. That's called duality. Mutual exclusives both being true is duality. And the attempt to, again, find that it's possible to comfort ourselves from the terrible confusion as if we can find serenity within conflict, you know, within mutual exclusives, that also has to arise. And so we have this whole package of duality. I just saw it as a package, as one package. That's it. There's no confusion. There's no confusion right now. There's no confusion about it. This is duality. This is the bad habit that we're in. And I tell you, the worst of all habits is that we keep seeking for some subtle answer. Because we'll never, as long as we keep doing that, we'll never see the package, the simple package simplicity of duality for what it is. We'll keep looking somewhere else. It's kind of like right in front of us, but we're seeking all these other places and getting all upset and confused and saying, wait a minute, you know, how do we do this? How do we do that? Whereas in fact, it's just right in front of us. You know, it's just completely obvious. That being said, our habits are so bad that it isn't easy to break bad habits. And the reason why we're not able to keep this simplicity continuous is because the ego says, well, I mean, what good is that? I mean, what happens when you run into all the complexity? What are you going to do then? There isn't any complexity to run into. So we abandon the safe position, easily abandon it for a confused position. In other words, the ego will say, well, when are you going to get to the heart of it and say, this is the heart of it? And the ego will say, no, it's not sophisticated enough. It's, you know, there's no subtlety to it. How are you going to deal with this when the subtlety of it all arises? I say, there is no subtlety to it that's going to arise. There is no subtlety to it at all. None. It's completely obvious. So remaining in the state of complete obviousness is enlightenment. Okay. That is enlightenment. Remaining in this recognition of the complete inevitable obviousness of it. With the deeper feeling of the perfect no to it. You know, that is what we are aiming for, actually. As soon as we look away from the obviousness of it, then we're lost. And of course, we've all experienced that numerous times, too many to count, actually. Because you got it, you get it just for an instant, you get it, and then it's gone. So wait a minute. It must have been so subtle I couldn't hold on to it. No, it was so obvious that we couldn't hold on to it. Because we believe we need to get a hold of subtlety. So this is the confusion we have. When we get a hold of it again, we instantly, almost instantly let it go. And then we conclude, my God, that was so subtle. Unbelievably, it just like vanished. It's super subtle. How do I get my mind wrapped around such subtlety? How do I find it, you know? It's the opposite. We let go of it because it's not subtle. you drop it like a hot potato. Say, whoa, that's not subtle at all. How, you know, that's too obvious. That can't be true. And we're so used to trying to combine mutual exclusives, which gives rise to infinite subtle considerations, right? Because it's impossible. So if we don't recognize the impossibility of it, we will have all these subtle considerations arise, innumerable, and they will continue on. And so we think, we're so used to struggling with all these complexities and subtleties that when we touch the obvious, we, wow, what is that? You know, gone, vanished, wow. You know, how subtle is the subtlest of subtleties? No, it's complete absence of subtlety. Complete absence of subtlety. So I experienced that this morning and now just here in recounting that. And there is a sort of a sorrow, like, wow, I've spent all this time chasing after rainbows, you know, and the whole while I already have the pot of gold. You know, I've been trying to find the gold at the end of the rainbow, and the whole time I already had the pot of gold right with me. And you know, there's a certain kind of feeling of sort of sadness about that. It's not quite sadness. It's a kind of a sobering feeling, like, wow. Brings a tear to your eye, you know, wow, I had it the whole while. It's right here. It's no need for any effort at all. It's just completely obvious, and I spent all this time and effort, tremendous suffering and misery, trying to find what was right, completely right, obvious, and with me the whole time. Wow. So there's a little bit of heaviness to it. Okay. One moment, please. I will be right back. So the spiritual path seems to be very frustrating and mysterious, right? It is. It's so difficult because we just can't seem to get it. I say, just something wrong with my mind. I'm not subtle enough. And it's the opposite. It's we're too subtle. We're so habituated to subtlety, we don't realize the world is an incredibly subtle place in terms of what it thinks it's doing, what it believes it's doing, etc., etc. But really, it's a completely obvious place. The attempt to comfort ourselves in this world, that is subtlety. The attempt to comfort ourselves with this situation, that requires just endless subtlety. It's just so baroque in so many ways. And the fact is, we can never, how can we be comfortable with mutual exclusives? I guarantee you for 100% certainty, we can never succeed at that. Because why? I experienced it directly. This is something that I can say for sure. It's not supposition on my part or speculation whatsoever. It is absolute fact for me. I know that is one thing that I know for sure. We can never abide in, be comfortable with mutual exclusives. The experience will always be one of a feeling of eternal disorientation, which is horrible. Total chaos, always. So it's futile. It's futile. And, you know, we've all been tricked and and gone down the road of that and believe that there's a way we can find a great comforter that will show us how to accomplish that and all this kind of stuff. And no. Those are just delaying tactics, really. Just delaying tactics. And all of this has to arise from our desire to replace God as prime creator. So the real spirit success on the spiritual path comes in redefining the path, actually. And at some point that has to take place. Redefining what the path is really about, what the goal is really after. I mean, how many subtle plans do we need to make when we're trying to catch the end of the rainbow, get the pot of gold at the end of the rainbow? How many subtle plans are necessary? Endless, right? You can dream up endless schemes. Okay, this is how we're going to do it. And we get, and everybody do this and you do that. And you can dream a whole universe about how to do it, and you can never do it. You can't catch it. There's no pot of gold there. And so, say, oh my gosh, meaning you can set it down as all as one package. It's just one little simple package, and you can see exactly what it is. That makes it easy to say, okay, let's just make a simple little exchange here. It's easy to drop the yes we can from the no we can't. The yes that we can, meaning yes we can learn how to die. Yes we can combine mutual exclusives. Let's put it that way. Yes we can combine mutual exclusives and be happy about it and abide in this as our new home. And the answer and the truth is no we can't. No we can't. Can't do it. There's no way. So, activity today on the street. What is this? The mail. The mail is coming. All right. Now the comforting principle is kind of like you're getting all these terrible cuts and gashes and wounds, and someone, a nurse is coming and say, oh, don't worry, I will clean the wound, I will sterilize it, I will dress it, I will put a bandage on it. There you go, honey, you know, you're fine. How's that? That help you out? You say, well, thanks, but it's still just hurting real bad. Boy, well, here's some opiates, here's some drugs to take and kill the pain. And are you happy? Well, thank you, yes. And it's the whole thing of comforting you, but you're getting just completely wiped out nonstop in existence. So you're just getting battered and bruised, and you might say existence is a case of complete domestic abuse, actually. We're all in an abusive relationship, actually. Trying to combine mutual exclusives is an abusive relationship, totally. And there's no amount of comforting that is going to change the stress and the strain and the pain and the suffering and misery of that. There's no amount of comforting. No way. What is comforting is to hear that you don't have to do that. It's impossible. That's what's comforting. That's the Holy Spirit has the perfect no from the very beginning. It didn't just figure it out. The Holy Spirit didn't come along and look at this and ponder and puzzle about it and say, wow, what is this? Finally get it. It's not like that. From the very beginning, the Holy Spirit, concurrent, simultaneously with the rising of the desire to be prime creator, is God created the Holy Spirit simultaneously saying, no, you cannot ever abide within mutual exclusives. It's impossible. No, you can't. You can't learn how to die. You can't learn how to be prime creator. You can't. It'll never work for you. No, you can't. So that's always been there. The Holy Spirit's never been confused at all. It knows, because it's really just totally simple. No, we can't. So we'll see how this goes. To see it all this way so clearly is a very good sign, actually. But you know, nothing extraordinary has happened at all. But abiding in this clarity is itself a meditation, actually. Listening to this on video is a meditation. It is a profound meditation. Because you're getting the vibe of the simplicity of it. And your mind is saying, whoa, wait, can you explain this? Can you explain this? Can you explain? Wait, you know, I said, where's the subtlety? There is no subtlety. There is no subtlety to it. And so just experience that. Like, oh my God, there's no subtlety to it. It's completely obvious. That is real meditation. That is profound meditation. And it is hitting me hard. You know, I'm not real hard. I mean, it's fine. But I mean, I'm feeling it. Carries weight. Carries weight. Feels weighty. You know, it's guru function is weightiness. Guru weightiness. It's profundity. You know, it's there's some weight to it. A lot of weight to it. And this truth, this clarity is here right now. It's here right now. It's true right now. Now time, what is time? Time is duality. Time is saying, yeah, okay, right now is true. But time is also true. So they'll both be true. You know, mutual exclusives. Time, the eternal now and time are mutual exclusives. And the ego says, ah, no problem. Let's just combine them. But if you've got time, you don't have the eternal now. If you have the eternal now, you don't have time. They're mutual exclusives. So, this is another example, another way of putting it. Again, the ego's got no choice but to go down the road of mutual exclusives, combining them. No choice. Because facts remain facts. They're still true. Truth is still true. And it has to acknowledge that, or else we drop the whole thing. Say this, you know, it wouldn't go anywhere. So the ego does acknowledge truth and say, sure, truth is true, no problem. And then it says, yeah, but lies are also true, and you can have both. You say, you'll be twice as true. Be twice as true. It says, you can have two nows, the eternal now and the now of time, you know, stuff like that. And then when you say, you feel all stressed out by it, then the ego will say, oh, I'll send you someone to comfort you and make you feel better about that. You know, I know it's hurting you right now, but eventually you'll get used to it. No, you don't. You can't get used to it. So when what you hear hits hard, or what you're seeing hits hard, that's good. Just let it hit. It's like eating a ghost pepper. You say, oh, that's hot. You say, okay, just sit back and experience the heat. Nothing much else to do. You know, once it hits, it hits. And you say, oh boy, here comes some heat, all right. So, it's great, and every time you do this, you're able to then take another step towards even more obvious, and even more obvious, and even more obvious. You'll find out there's a progression, and you'll find out that you're able to see things simply, and this has a profound effect on you. And then you just get used to that effect on you, and then you see it even more simply, and even more obvious. A Course in Miracles starts out with, what does it say? This course can be summed up with one phrase. Truth is true and nothing else is true. So the entire, all the words, it starts out by saying, look, all these words you're going to hear, really all you need is just to accept this one statement. That's all you need. And if you can see that and accept that statement, you don't need any of the words. You don't need any of them. So A Course in Miracles said, Jesus said, look, the purpose of this course is to make itself unnecessary. And in my case, that's what I found. It's exactly how it worked. Don't need the words anymore. I can see it. the simplicity of that, that I can see how duality has to arise from our desire to try to be prime creator. It has to be this combining or holding of mutual exclusives. Has to say, yeah, truth is true and lies are also true. It has to be that. There's no other way. We can do it no other way. And we have to say no to that. It's not possible to abide in that. It's not possible. That's all you need to know. Nothing else. You need to know, don't need to know anything else, really, as far as seeing it as it is. And then you simply abide in this clarity, and there's a feeling like it has some sort of effect on you. It's not unpleasant. It's not particularly pleasant or not particularly unpleasant. It might be kind of a dampening down of reactions in the system. It might be something like that. It's possible. Because Jesus also says that the real feeling is not of the body. It's spiritual feeling. And the body itself should be neutral. So this may be like some sort of neutraling down sort of sensation, that I feel like I'm neutraling down. That's probably something along those lines. And that also helps one focus in on the simplicity even more, because the reactions are simply not there. Sri Ananda Mahima said that one of the certain signs as real progress on the spiritual path is you find yourself incapable of hating anyone or anything, really hating. And I found that to be true also. That I don't really hate anyone. I really can't. It's hard for me to generate anger or hate towards anything. I try to hate the Los Angeles Dodgers, being a Giant fan, but I really can't do that anymore either. You know, it's like, I can't quite muster any of that. It doesn't last. So it may just be... Now, there are some... And I've been there. I know what it's like. They want to generate, try to make, expand the subtlety of emotional feeling, of reactions. They want to expand the subtlety of reactions. Okay, and physical sensory reactions. And so they don't want this feeling like, oh my gosh, that I feel I'm going into this neutral state in terms of reactivity. And so they won't like it. They'll feel it. They'll panic. But I'm not panicking at all. I don't feel any panic. I welcome it. Artists want that reactivity. They want very fine emotional reactivity, so they know how to play upon all this reactivity in other people. In other words, their audience. They want to know how to play on the senses of their audience. But here, it's a different goal. Which is peace of mind and bliss, actually bliss, which is a spiritual feeling. Doesn't come from the senses. It doesn't come from the body. So my supposition is that in abiding in this clarity, it somehow is producing this deep calming effect. Even though on the surface, I feel the same. I feel the same on the surface. So as far as surface functionality goes, I don't notice any change. I've never noticed any change. So it must be, it's kind of like a remodeling job on a house where the paint stays the same, the house, same color, and everything has been remodeled, but like the paint, the same color, and people go down the street and they look and they say, oh, you know, they don't notice anything. Same color paint, plants are the same. You know, maybe you keep the front door the same or whatever, and nobody really notices. But inside, it's been completely remodeled. the back, everything clear. Well, just the front looks the same. And then one day, I guess, you have a crew come in, and they just do a few little things in front, and then poof, pop. You know, the curb appeal is, it changes every, and people say, wow, look at that house. And then they open the front door, and they look inside. It's like, you know, whoa, wow. You know, it's just amazing. It's kind of like that. I mean, the frontal self has just stays the same. Hasn't changed. And interestingly enough, as this process has been going on, and I'm getting to this real clarity, there's just before this happened, I mean, this happened this morning, in the last week or so, the last couple days too, I've been frantic to try and work on some real sophisticated graphics and artwork and everything like that. Or I got to go somewhere to stimulate emotion and, you know, and all this stuff. And it's like, it was like panicking almost, saying, oh my gosh, it must have been a feeling like, oh my gosh, I'm about to lose all this emotional, you know, subtlety, reactionary subtlety, as it were. It's going to be dampened down. So I did experience that. I experienced like this time of almost like frantic, and I was aware of it. I said, no, just do a little bit. Don't go overboard. It's okay. Don't do too much. Just this will pass. So there is that last kind of feeling like, oh my gosh, I must maintain my subtlety in terms of emotional subtlety. Bliss, you know, from what I understand is not subtle at all. It's completely obvious. It's very steady, it's very calm, it's very peaceful. Unchanging, unfluctuating. But it's expansive, it's overflowing. There's an overflowingness, there's a joy to it, a bliss to it, you know, a peace to it, all of that. But it's not the same as all this emotional reactivity. It's not. So I must have felt that my emotional reactivity is about ready to die. It's going to die. And I wanted to get in the last meal, you know, the last supper, and overeating. You know, where's the ice cream? Where's the pizza? You know. Where's the cool, you know, where's the crowds? You know, I was feeling, let's go on an adventure, a trip, you know, anything. Let me get into this graphics. Let me do a documentary. Let me just do all this stuff. I was just like, felt this extreme push. You got to do it. You got to do it. You got to do it. It's now or never. It's now or never. You know, that kind of thing. And I said, you know, look, it's okay. It's okay. It's not that important. It's not that important. It's not that important. Definitely there's something along these lines taking place right here. And when this, you know, completes somehow, the dampening down, neutrality effect completes, then the frontal self will probably get a new coat of paint. And then people will probably notice that there's something different. Like, whereas, you know, right now, I guarantee you, I go around, do everything I've always done, everything, and nobody pays the slightest attention to me. There's nothing of any interest. Occasionally, I've had, there are phases I've gone through with people, for some reason, just stop and stare at me with their mouths open, and then that passes, and then people just ignore me. And then another phase, of people will be just looking at me like that, and they'll just, and then another phase, will just completely ignore me. So there's somehow, like, there are times when the frontal self must somehow be letting something through, and people will just be just like, they'll just stop. It seems very rude, actually. Really. But I've gotten used to it. But most of the time, people just pass me by like, there's nobody there. It's not even, no importance whatsoever. Just, you know, just a average Joe, whatever. And I try to keep it that way. Because when you tell people, oh, you're going to lose your subtlety, they panic because they think that their success and comfort and happiness comes from subtlety. People assume the teachers are like some of these incredibly subtle beings. Not true at all. got this one cricket going. It's wonderful. Chirping, cicada, whatever it is. Wonderful chirp going already. What time is it? 5:40. It's a wonderful chirp going. And the sad thing is that people think if they have this all this subtlety of trickeration, that they're getting it, they're finally getting it, they're advancing. It's just the opposite. But they don't see it that way. They feel they're going to get that pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, but they're on their way to succeeding. But this can go on indefinitely. Indefinitely. Never getting it. So I think that sitting with an enlightened being, people are afraid to do so because they start feeling this neutrality, you know, entering, feel this, and they want to ask questions. They say, whoa, I'm losing my subtlety. Hey, teacher, I've got a very subtle question for you. And teachers indulge it, you know, to a certain extent, and realizing that there's this process that's going on. But most people think the teacher's going to make them feel more emotionally subtle and more capable of this, you know, chasing after that rainbow. And even finding a double rainbow. Just the opposite. Just the opposite, so. Yeah, it'd be really cool to sit with a teacher sometime. I really, that's one of the things I really would enjoy, but it's never happened. I guess you might say that's on my bucket list, but yeah, I don't know. I don't see how that can happen. I cannot really, you know, find the one that I can see. It's obvious you can see that. They're simply dwelling in the completely obvious. But maybe the Holy Spirit will arrange it for me, I don't know. There's really no need to say anything, because what the teacher is in the accepted the complete obvious and accepted bliss and the presence is just right there, you know, it's there. Right now, it's there. It's not somewhere in the future, it's right now. And so you don't have to say anything. It can be felt, it can be experienced, it's obvious. The whole thing is obvious, the teacher is a teacher, you know, it's obvious. So what do you need to say? You just abide in the obviousness of it, which is the whole point of the situation anyway. And then that has this effect on us that we don't need to go chasing after the non-obvious. We don't need to go chasing after the non-obvious. This is the heavy, heavy realization that means, hey, you're home. You're already home. It's like that story by the Mullah Nasruddin saying, Sufi saying, that somebody was frantically searching for a key and to the door, and he's so freaked out and he's tearing things apart, sofas apart, beds apart, looking here and there, tearing floorboards up, and just in tears and just ready to kill himself, you know. He's like, I can't find the key to the door. I just cannot find the key, you know, and I'll never get in. I'll never get in. I'll never open that door, you know. It's just, I can't take it anymore. And the saint says, you know, what do you need a key for? You're already inside your house. You're not outside, you're already inside your house. It's like that. So we're chasing after all the subtlety when we already have the answer, meaning it's already completely apparent, very apparent. All we have to do is stop chasing after subtlety, actually. And it automatically arises in your mind, the obviousness of it. Oh yeah, of course, this is what has to arise. I can see it, it's plain as day, it's so simple. Once you stop chasing after all the subtlety, it's there. It's already there. We're already inside the house. We don't have to find the key. And we get so distraught because we can't find the key. It must be hidden somewhere. We're just looking everywhere, high and low. Where is it hidden? I can't find it. How do I get in my house? I can't figure it out. We're already in the house. This is just, it's a metaphor for our situation. My dad used to, he had this book, The Sayings of Mullah Nasruddin, and at dinner table he'd make sure he'd read two or three of those, and I always just laughed and laughed. I thought it was the greatest thing. Other people, he was like, oh, God, not again. Why are we wasting the time with this foolishness, So I would say it is this dampening down effect that people might get jittery about. So if you're feeling jittery right now, consider that this is what's happening. This is what's probably happening. You're just saying, oh my gosh, I'll never be a superstar of the art world. I'll never be a superstar. I'll never have great audiences that I'm inspiring emotionally. I'll never be an opera star. I'll never put on a big song and dance production. All this razzle-dazzle entertainment. I'll never be a doyen of the entertainment world. Never be the big cheese grinding out Hollywood movies. I'll never do that. And there's an inner jitteriness saying, oh my gosh, is this worth the price I'm going to pay? The death of subtlety, as it were. I'll never be seen as some super subtle superstar. Yeah. Now and on to my mind says, you're just a simpleton. He said, I'm just a tiny little child, complete simpleton. That's all I am. Nothing other than that. I'm sorry if you want me to be something else. I'm incapable of doing it. We all wanted her to be this great mother, the comfort of them, and she just would sit there and, gazing. But they asked her, and she said, no, I'm just a little child, simpleton, complete simpleton. Because truth is completely simple, completely obvious. So obvious even a tiny child can get it. We don't need, we don't need to be these super sleuth, super searchers and seekers, adults that are so capable at doing incredible efforts towards, towards finding the subtle answers. Don't need any of that. I remember Ananda Mahima went down to Pondicherry to see Mother of Pondicherry. I don't know if Sri Aurobindo was still alive then or not. Maybe not. But and they got into this think they're on a balcony, and and there are people there, and then they got into this exchange, and each one kept saying that they were, that they were the child, they were the real child, and it went back and forth, and eventually, Ananda, my mom, prevailed, and she said, "No, I'm the little child. You know, you're the mother, but no, I am the little child. I am the littlest little child possible. You're the mother, not me. I'm not." And eventually, because that was true. That was true. Because total simplicity of mind, which is bliss, which is seeing the obvious as obvious instead of subtle. So she was pointing out something to Mother Panacheri, saying, "You're still, you know, in the mother mode of comforting, and that she would not allow herself to be seen as a mother, you know, not to my mom, no, not to her, not to others, she would." So it was really a compliment to the mother of Pondicherry, actually, of insisting on this. A lot of times she would not insist, because people couldn't take it, they couldn't take it. So I'm just allowing this neutralizing effect to continue. That's why you in satsang and inquiry, you stay calm, you stay quiet, you stay calm, because you don't act out there. See, that's taboo, really, because you're not trying to keep alive all this foam and froth and frill and all this kind of stuff. You're letting it all settle down. You're letting all the sediment settle down so the lake becomes clear, okay? And there's no need to make a big drama, a big fuss about it. You just sit there quietly and say, "That's not so bad. It's not so bad." Because there is this tendency to panic and say, "Oh my gosh, I need to act out something. I need emotional drama. I need emotional drama." And the rules of satsang is no emotional drama, because that disturbs everybody else and triggers there. They're fighting against it too. Everybody's in the same boat. They're saying, "Whoa, you know, I'm going through this, and I don't want to go towards emotional drama, you know. But I'm tempted. But I don't really want to go there. So." Please, nobody try and activate it, you know. Keep it, it's everybody, keep it calm, keep it quiet. Now, I'm just theorizing here that the bliss comes when one no longer is panicky about the vanishing of subtlety, subtle emotional drama, all emotional dramas of seeking. That would be a conjecture. That would be a reasonable look at it, actually. So hopefully, you know, well, I hope I'm close to it. You know, who wouldn't hope? Who wouldn't hope, actually? But, you know, I don't really have any way to actually assess it, you know. Don't really know what the depths of reactivity are in us, do we? Really don't know. It's really dying before you die, which is what is necessary. Die before you die. Be born again. Another way of putting it. Be born as the child of simplicity. Die before you die means all this emotional reactivity dies, settles down into neutral Like, in other words, you shake up a bottle full of detergent, all these bubbles are there, and you sit it down and let it gradually, that all settles down. Eventually, all the bubbles, you know, are gone. Takes a while. So we're just letting the bubbles settle. As far as reactions, emotional reactions, I'm feeling nothing. No, I'm not feeling other than just kind of a deep sort of feeling of something settling down. There's no particular reactions at all. So you want to practice that in inquiry. You want to get to that, which is why we don't bring up politics and quote unquote, you know, religion, mainstream religion, politics. We try not to bring up too much of that. But on the same hand, you're not trying to be rigidly exclusive of everything either. You're not fanatical about it, because that in itself is drama. Fanaticism is drama too, you see. So we're just kind of blasé about everything. I mentioned the possibility of trouble caused from space rocks because we need to recognize the urgency of continuing with this, of letting yourself settle down. There's urgency to it. In other words, don't keep pursuing all this emotional drama in your life, because the world is going to overload us with drama, as a matter of fact, and complexity, yeah, very soon. And so if we are still hooked into that, then we're going to get overwhelmed, overloaded, actually. So we need to, very important to spend time settling down. So I mean, I hope I settle down, you know, soon, so I can be more useful to people, because really, time is running very short for that. But you can, you know, talk about things in a very sort of just a very superficial way, as just chit-chat, but not be emotionally invested in it in any way. Nice day today. It's a beautiful day today. Every day out here in California is just incredible, actually, right now. It's just golden sunshine every day. Fog in the morning. Cool fog in the morning. Burns off about noon. Gorgeous day now. Wonderful, mellow sunset and evening. Just incredible. So, you know, you can talk about that, say something like that. But very superficial. There's no emotional reactions going on. Yeah, World Series is starting tomorrow. Should be a good contest. I think Boston will probably win because they got home field. But two very evenly matched teams, both won 97 games. And they do all the little things right. And so it should be really quite an incredible World Series. But you never know what's going to happen. I mean, maybe one team will sweep the other. You never know. So again, you know, just chit-chat. But meanwhile, I still feel the whole settling down thing is still taking place. It's not agitating. See, it's not agitational. You're not shaking the bottle more. You're just still, it's still sitting there. Someone who comes to satsang inquiry, where'd you come from? You came from there. Oh, what country are you from? Where are you from? Oh, okay. How's your trip? You know. Yeah. And we'll talk about this, a little chit chat. How's everything going here? You got everything's going okay? Yeah. Oh, that's good. People, you know, just let every, it's a settling down. People are there to let everything settle down, but in a profound way. It's not the settling down of the hatha yoga, of, you know, that's a superficial settling down, that the ego is saying, hey, I can settle down too, you know, let me, you let me do that. And then after you've done that, hey, I feel recharged and I can go out there and get a whole bunch more drama, you know, go more seeking. I'm now a better seeker than before. That's really not the settling down that we're talking about here. Settling is profound. You can't even put your finger on it, really. But you can feel deep inside this. It's sort of like it's your whole nervous system, your whole mechanism of reactivity is somehow, it's like you've turned off the switch of a fan, and the fan is slowly going around slower and slower and slower and slower and slower. And you realize that you see, wow, the fan is slowing down. It's going to stop. At some point, it's going to stop. That's how I feel. You know, it could stop any moment. That's why I'm getting frantic with, I need to do something artistic. I did something last night. Very artistic. Because when the fan stops, you know, wow, what happens then? So those who really make use of those opportunities are really being helped a lot. There's no question about it. The teeth of the inquiry is in this settling down towards neutrality. Neutral reactivity is just, because we've based our life on that, haven't we? We think that is life. It's not life. It's trying to find comfort where it can never be found, actually. But we think it's life, and we think that we're losing our life. Like, oh, my life is coming to an end. And so what most people do is they try to die before the fan stops, thinking they can't take it. They don't want to experience their life coming to an end, so they might as well the body die so they don't have to actually experience the life coming to an end. In my case, I want to experience it coming to an end before the body dies, for sure. So I'm eagerly, you know, I'm full on expecting it. But better hurry up, because the body's not in such great shape right now. So you see a lot of people sort of seem to be take the spiritual path, but you know in the back of their mind, you talk to them, they're planning to die before they succeed, actually. But most people are that way. And they can say, well, I almost made it. So there is this inner adjustments taking place, like, wow, so this is, I thought this was life. It's not. It's all bogus, the whole thing. None of this is anything that I really want. So it carries that wow factor to it. Well, it's interesting. I can't find any satsang to go to. So I'm having to do my own here, you know. That's how it's worked out. bliss, when you have bliss, you're always in bliss. Real bliss means you're always in bliss. No matter what you look at, no matter where you are, you're always in bliss. Everything else is just drama. Like, how can I succeed? How can I succeed in mutual exclusives? How are we going to do this? And, oh, I think I know an incredibly sophisticated way. I found some magical way. I'm very magical, you know, I found a magical way. That's what, and no, there's no magical way. And we think, well, I won't be interesting to people. People won't like me and they won't be interested in me. Well, some won't. Some will. It's true that I have a very interesting story to tell because I know my previous lives, especially the one just previous to this. I know exactly what I did. And, I was able to produce tremendously subtle emotional drama, and people really said, you know, people were really interested in that, and nobody passed me by. Everybody knew who I was, and this life is the opposite. Everybody passes me by. Nobody cares about me at all because I'm not producing any emotional drama at all. I mean, no interest. So, it's definitely true that when you trade upon emotional drama and produce all the subtlety in that, people will say, wow, this is really something. This is great. Aren't you wonderful? You're a hero. You're fantastic and all this kind of stuff. You've heard that, you know. You get these cheerleaders. Drama cheerleaders who are great at saying, oh, you're so fantastic, you're so beautiful, you're so incredible, wow, you know, yeah, you know, you're so subtle, this is so profound, all this kind of stuff, trying to, you know, pump you up to keep churning out this subtlety, you know, of expression and all that kind of stuff. But it doesn't work, that's not it. So in this life, nobody's interested in me. In the world in general, no way. Unknown. That's funny. Complete opposite. Complete opposite experience. And it's always caused me kind of freak out, like, wow, how's that possible? That one minute people, well, I tell you, it's like going into stores when you have money and you're spending liberally. And you buy from the store, all the stuff you're buying. You walk into the store one morning, and everybody's your friend. I mean, oh, wow, how are you? It's great to see you again. How you been? Really? That's terrific. Man, it's anything you need, any kind of help. I mean, we're just here to help you. This is just, you know, just smiling, and everybody's smiling. Oh, our friend is here again. How you doing? Visiting with you and stuff. And then when you don't have any more money, you spend it all, and you go back in the store for old time's sakes just to, you know, browse around again, nobody even knows who you are. The same people that were your best friend, they don't even realize you're even there. It's like you're not even there. I've been through this. I know exactly what that's like. I know many people have been through this experience, and it's just like, wow. Become uninteresting to the world. When you don't have money, when you don't have any subtlety of emotional expression and drama to give, you're no longer interesting to the world. But you become of interest to those who are going through the same process. Because they're saying, hey, you know, this process is really, I'm not sure what's going on. And for those who do know what's going on, then that's reassuring. That's reassuring. So you have some quotient of reassurance to some people in the world. But to the mainstream, you know, you really, they see nothing in you, really. Well, they might say, if you're really in bliss, they might say, well, you're a nice person, really nice person, very peaceful and nice person. But that's it, you know, no further interest. But that's okay, that's okay. Having been a person of note, noteworthy, where everybody knew my name, everybody knew who I was, that was kind of a drag, actually. Didn't like it. Couldn't escape. You know, it's just like these people, these athletes, you know, everyone knows who they are. So they go out and you know, everybody notices them. And you know, some people, they just can't take it. They become recluses, you know. Really? I mean, I felt like I wanted to be a recluse this life. You want the public to leave you alone, because after a while, it's just the same old, you know, okay, can you sign your autograph? Oh, can I have your autograph? Can you take a picture with me? And it's just, and you realize, my God, it's so superficial. And you're not really helping these people. And it's just, you just want to escape it. A lot of celebrities want to escape celebrity. You know, I ended up dying to escape it. You know, a lot of celebrities, they die, they overdose on drug, whatever, because they hate celebrity and they can't escape it. And on the other hand, being completely unknown is not a pleasant thing either. It's not, being a recluse is not a pleasant thing either. Neither one is pleasant. So there are some people in the world that are interested in bliss, and so they're interested. So that's fine, that's just how it is. Can't interest everybody equally. That's mutual exclusives again right there. Eventually, but it takes delay, delays a lot. A lot of people are very delayed, a lot of bad habits. So people might think, we're just chatting about nothing here, what's the big deal? No, the work is going on inwardly of settling down to neutrality. That's what's taking place. And we're actually very much active in a certain way of allowing this to take place without jumping into any drama, you see. There's a focus and a clarity and a discipline here, even though we don't seem to be doing anything, we're just chit-chatting. Not allowing the mind to stray anywhere, right? We're just keeping it just right here, right here. And that's tremendous discipline, clarity, effort, determination. And it's not just sitting quietly, like, look, watching a sunset. It's not the same thing. We're not talking about just nature. We're talking about letting this whole drama die. The whole drama of the search, letting it all die, letting it die. So we're really kind of, what we're really doing is we're like, you know, like someone is passing away and you're in the bedroom there with them, and people are in the chairs around and you're just sitting quietly like there. It's like that. It's kind of like that, actually. That's a pretty good metaphor. Nobody's saying anything. People are quiet, respectful. And they're just letting this person, you know, pass away quietly and peacefully. And you know there's nothing you can do at this point. It's too late for that. I was told, for me now, it's too late as far to stop it from happening. No matter what I do, it's going to happen. So I can do a whole bunch of works with graphics and pictures and images and all, the movie, whatever, and it's still going to happen. But I'd rather have it happen, you know, nice and smoothly. So you're sort of waiting for something to die, as it were. What is dying? Death is dying. So we're waiting for death to die, and that does require, you know, a lot of nerve and focus. Absolutely. Waiting for death to die. Now, a lot of the world's not ready for death to die, so they're going to keep it alive, keep death alive. And that's coming up. Big push for that. There's a big push for that. Keep death alive. Yes, we can keep death alive. But we're saying, no, for us, no, we can't. We can't keep death alive any longer. It's dying. It's passing away very quickly. So that's the experience I'm having, is I'm aware that that death is dying. And there is just a trace of a tear, you know, over it. Because it was all so unnecessary, you know. But, I mean, there was an inevitability to it all, I guess, which is kind of, it's hard that, wow, all of this was bound to happen. It's unavoidable. It's unavoidable. That's kind of shocking. It was unavoidable, all of this. Wow. The suffering we've been through, it's unavoidable. Bound to arise from our desire to be Prime Creator. It's unavoidable. So, all right, we'll just, this can go on, this can go on. You can do your own sitting, you know, your own sitting. So this is real spiritual practice. This is real meditation, real contemplation. This has teeth to it. Real has real teeth to it. Still does. I got a really strong. So you know, you have some idea what to expect. If you're not having this right now, you have some idea of what to expect, and you realize, hey, that's not so tough. I don't need to be afraid of that. So the wait continues. We're waiting for death to die. And this will continue. This will continue. And in one whom death has died, you know, you can tell. You can tell, wow, death is gone. It doesn't live there anymore. It's dead. Death is dead. Good analogy. Very good. And of course, if someone's passing away, it's not like you're cheerleading, like, come on, die, hurry up, die, hurry up, die. Yeah, of course you're not saying that. Because that it just shows you just can't take it. You know, you really don't, you know, you really don't want it to really happen. It says, I can't take this anymore. Hurry up and die. Push the river. That's a very dramatic thing to do. You know, respect the process. Death is dying. Let it die. And certainly, well, there are certain things you do. You're not, you take the IV out. You know, basically, you, once you take the IV out, you take the assisted breathing off. Mask, oxygen mask off, the IV out, various things, you detach them, you know. Once you detach that, then you know, okay, this is it, and so it's like that. I sort of feel like that. I've taken out the IV and taken off the oxygen tank and mask, and if you have somebody on assisted, you know, assisted life support, you detach all the life support stuff, you know, okay, this is it. And you say, oftentimes right before someone passes away, there's a burst of, you know, vigor or something like, hey, I want to live again. That's very common, actually. And people think, oh my gosh, they're getting better. They're recovering, a miraculous recovery. No, it's just before they let go of the body, there's a feeling like, oh, I still want to use it, you know, and suddenly they're reinvigorated for a little while. Just like that creativity, said, oh my God, I gotta do this creativity, you know, and before I go into bliss where I won't be, you know, playing on the emotions, the subtlety emotions of anyone anymore. Very similar. So it's pretty interesting. Dying before you die, I get to experience my own death. that's pretty cool. We should all, you know, aim for that. Say, hey, yeah, that's very cool. Not many get to experience their own death and live to tell about it. And we're not talking about near-death experiences here. We're talking about the actual death and does not come back. Death does not come back. It dies and it doesn't return. And we get to experience that. So that's a unique experience. That's a very cool experience. Looking forward to it. Once you see it so clearly, there's no escaping it. You know, it just. It's like taking the personality off life support, really. Really, once you see it that clearly, it's like taking off life support. That is exactly what it's like. Because it's inescapable. You see it and say, wow, you can't escape that. Can't escape it. I see it. That's it. So we'll see how it goes. Embrace the now, embrace where we're at. Keep your poise as if you're in a room and someone is dying and you just have this decorum, you know. That's the decorum, really. Just think about that. Easy to what's the decorum of inquiry satsang? Decorum of you're sitting in a room and someone of your family or relative, friend is passing away, and you've taken them off life support. You're that's the decorum to have. Just think about it. Easy to know the decorum. You're not there to socialize. You're not there to hit on somebody. You're not there to get people interested in you. You know, you're not there to play on emotions, subtle emotions, play. You're not there for any. No. All that stuff. You realize, hey, forget about that stuff. And very naturally, you take on the right, you know, demeanor. Very naturally. Most people do. There are some people, few, who don't. It's all about them, you know, it's all about drama. They can't stand the not having drama, so they still want to draw attention to themselves and act up and all this kind of stuff. And, you know, that happens. All right, so this continues. The death watch continues. Continues.